Hello guys, welcome to The Smart Student. My name is Chelsea Seaburn. So in this video, I'm going to be talking about how to add tables and figures to your academic papers under APA 7th edition. Now I have a few quick notes before we get started. So this topic is fairly complex, so the way this is going to work is that this video is going to be everything you need to know about tables and figures, and then I've created a second video for demonstration purposes. That video can be found linked down in the description below, along with everything else APA formatted related. So be sure to check out that playlist while you're down there as well. But with no further ado, let's go ahead and get started. So what's the purpose of tables and figures? Well, tables and figures are used to present large amounts of data in a comprehensible way. Therefore, the purpose of them is to improve the reader's understanding of your work. Now, as a rule of thumb, while tables and figures do improve the appearance of your papers, they should never be used for decorative purposes, meaning they should always serve a purpose when it comes to understanding your research. Awesome, so what's the difference between a table and a figure? Well, a table usually shows any type of numerical value like statistics or textual information such as respondents from a study. The data in a table is always arranged in a row column structure, whereas a figure on the other hand is any other type of graph, chart, photograph, drawing, illustration. Honestly, the easiest way to depict between the two is that tables use a row column formatting, whereas a figure is any other type of photograph or illustration, any other type of visual representation. Since the purpose of tables and figures is to further the reader's understanding of your work, it's best to create them with the reader in mind. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and talk about formatting. So to start, while tables and figures are different, they follow the same structure and contain the same five components. Those components are a number identifier, a title, labels, a body portion, and any necessary notes as they're needed. While they're very similar, they do contain minor differences when it comes to the body portion. So you understand what I mean, let's go ahead and walk through an example of each one. All right, so starting with the table, here's what the end result might look like. By the way, the video I mentioned at the beginning of this video where I walk you through a demonstration of actually building a table, this is the table that I'm building. So if you're interested in watching that tutorial, again, be sure to check out this video up here. Anyways, starting with the first component, which is the number identifier. The number identifier will always be the first component in your table, and it should be located flush left, typed in bold, like you see it is here. This is table number one because it's the first table in my document. If I had a second table, you would label that table number two, and so on and so forth. Next, you have the table title. This should be typed out using capital case and italic fonts. Capital case meaning that all major words are capitalized. Moving on to the next component, which is the body portion of the table. Now you already know that tables are made up of rows and columns. Those rows and columns are what are considered the body portion. They can be either single, 1.5, or double spaced. This example is using single space lines. When you create your own tables, you'll decide which spacing is most appropriate for your document. One thing I'd like to point out here is that everything outside the body portion should follow the same double spaced spacing as the rest of your paper. The next component is your headings, and headings are what you use to label your columns and your rows. Now, there are a few different variations on the different types of headings, but in general, all tables will use column headings and stub headings. Column headings are simply the top headings going vertical, and a stub heading is the heading for the leftmost column. Final component is your notes. If you include those, they'll be included directly underneath your table, and the purpose of them is simply to describe parts of the table that are not easily understood on their own. There are three different levels of notes, including general, specific, and probability. For time purposes, I'm not going to go into those here, but I will say this. General notes come first, followed by specific, and then probability, like you see they are layered here in this example. Now moving on to the figure example. Like I said before, they contain the same five components with minor differences to the body. As you can see here, you have the number identifier coming first, typed out in bold, flush left. Rather than saying table one, you would label this figure one, signifying that it's a figure. Underneath the figure number comes a title, which, similar to the table, should follow the same capital case in italic font. Next, you have the body of the figure. And the first minor difference to note here is that rather than calling it the body, it's referred to as the image. Depending on what type of figure you're creating, the image could be a chart, graph, photograph, illustration. The image in this case is a graph. The other minor difference to notice is how the elements in the image are labeled. Similar to how headings label the different components in a table, you would use a legend to label the different elements in a figure. Something to note is that a legend is sometimes referred to as a key. But if you're using a legend, it should be placed within the border of your image like you see it is here. Lastly, the notes element is the exact same for a figure as it would be for a table. But now I want to talk about the creation of tables and figures. But when it comes to creating a table, you want to create it using the table function in your word processing system, either Google Docs or Microsoft Word, whichever one you're using. If you're copying and pasting it from another source, you may have to adjust the formatting once it's in the document, but as a rule of thumb, you should never use the key function or the space bar to create the look of a table. This approach is well known to creating formatting issues, so you just want to avoid it at all costs. Now, if you're creating a figure, there is far more flexibility on how you can create them. The reason being is that there are far more softwares you can choose from, some of the most popular being Excel, PowerPoint, any Adobe suite like Photoshop or Illustrator. But regardless of the software you're using, the one thing you want to note about figures is that you want to make sure the resolution is high enough to create high quality images that'll look nice in your document. Once you're finished creating your table or figure, you have two options when it comes to placement. You can either place the asset on its own page after the reference list, or you can embed it within the text of your paper. Either option is completely fine and acceptable for student papers, where placement usually isn't specified. Now, regardless of where you place it in your paper, the asset should always be aligned flush left. Likewise, if you're embedding your asset within the text of your paper, it should always appear after a full paragraph, ideally after the first paragraph where you mention it. Whether you're using a table or a figure, you always want to aim for it to fit on one page, meaning you should avoid splitting the asset between two pages. The last thing to note when it comes to placement is that there should always be one double space line separating your asset from the text in your paper. When you refer to a table or figure in your paper, this is known as a call out. And the most common way to call out a table or figure is by using its identifying number. When you call out an asset, you always want to make sure you tell the reader what to look for as well. In other words, never put in your paper, "Please refer to table 3," without something finishing that sentence, telling the reader why they're referring to table 3. So you have a few options in your tool belt. Let's walk through a few examples of what a proper call out would look like. So you can call out the table or figure at the beginning of your sentence or at the end. So for example, as shown in table 1, the demographic characteristics, fill in the blank. Figure 2 shows the event-related potentials, fill in the blank. Those are examples of how you would call out the asset in the beginning of a sentence. If you were calling it out at the end of your sentence, you could use parentheses to format it. For example, blank of the results of the testing, see table 3. Blank of the comparisons, see figures 4 and 7. One thing to note is that no matter how you're calling out the asset, the word table in figure is capitalized. You never want to call out a table or figure ambiguously by saying something like, "Please refer to the table above or below," or "Please refer to the table on page 32. As a rule of thumb, page numbers often shift during the writing process, so calling out an asset in this manner can cause confusion for the reader. All right, in this last section, I want to go over a few principles to follow when you're creating tables and figures in APA formatting. So starting with labeling, you should label all columns in tables and label all elements in figures. And no matter what you're labeling, the label should always be placed directly next to the element it's labeling. Next, comparisons. When you're comparing two items, no matter if it's a table or a figure, the comparisons should always be placed directly next to each other. Now, let's talk about font. As a rule of thumb, you should always use a font that is legible and large enough for the reader to easily read it without having to magnify it. Honestly, I personally suggest continuing with the same font that you're using in your document. My font of choice is Times New Roman size 12 because it's a safe font that's widely accepted. Next, standalone. Meaning that you should always create tables and figures so that they could be understood on their own. So while you're supposed to tell readers what to look for when you call them out in your text, a reader should never have to refer to your text to understand what they're looking at. Lastly, avoid decorative elements. So I already kind of mentioned this before, but as a rule of thumb, if an element doesn't serve a purpose when it comes to understanding, go ahead and leave it out. You should only include elements that further the reader's understanding of your table or figure. Anyways, if you're still here right now, thank you so much for sticking this video through. I hope it helped clear up some of the confusion between tables and figures, which I'm sure you probably noticed, they're not all that different when it comes to structuring and formatting. Again, if you want to watch a demonstration of how to actually create one, be sure to check out this video up here. And also, if you need help with anything else APA related, I have a full playlist down in the description below. And while you're down there, don't forget to join the Smart Student Facebook group. And as always, be sure to give this video a big thumbs up if you enjoyed it, share it with your friends, and subscribe to the Smart Student channel for more videos.